Every week we're going to have different people to come and testify about God's goodness in their life. So, you know, you just want to follow us, especially on the social media, and get a sense, you know, because this week, you know, we have a good-looking guy, Douglas, coming. So, you know, you may have some nephews, nieces. You say, hey, it's awesome. Another week, we could have a housewife. And that could be good, right? You could say, you know, I have neighbors that are all homemakers, and it's relevant to them, bring them, okay? So we're going to try different people to come. And sure, another day, we're going to have, you know, a singer, an actor, different ones, a politician maybe, maybe not politics at the moment. Okay, but you get the point. Anyway, today we're going to do this conversation about sharing the gospel to a dying world. And I really want to look at one passage today. It's a long passage. I'm going to do my best to kind of help you through the passage as quickly as we can. Sharing the gospel to a dying world. Let's look at Acts chapter 17. We're going to see where Paul is going with this, okay? Starting from verse 16. Now, look at the Bible on screen as well. Now, when Paul was waiting for them in Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city of Athens was full of idols. Now, let's pause here, okay? So, you see what's happening, right? Paul is just traveling about. He's in the city of Athens. Athens is beautiful. Some of you, I'm sure you have seen on the map or you've been there. Now, his spirit was provoked. He was very angered, not at the beautiful sight of Athens, obviously, but he saw everywhere he went in Athens, he saw so many idols. And, you know, you said, why is he angry at idols? He's not angry at idols per se. He's angry at what idols would do. Right? Because with idols, it leads to idolatry. And men's and women's hearts are prone to go towards a direction that you will want to worship something or someone. You either worship the true God, or you worship a substitute. And Paul was saying, wow, there's tons of God substitutes in this city. And he was provoked that there was something that stirred in him. And verse 17, so he reasoned in a synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. How do we know that Paul is so excited to share the gospel? Is that he saw a need in the city of Athens, right? And because of that, he knew, wow, the people here really need to hear about Jesus. Because they don't hear about Jesus, they are all worshipping so many different types of idols. Now, you see what happens next, verse 18. The Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also spoke with him. And some said, what does this babbler wish to say? Others said, he seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. Verse 19, and they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new teaching is that you're presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these mean. So it's quite clear, right? We are seeing that they are confused, but yet interested to hear what Paul has to say. And the truth is, friends, many times we think that maybe people are not interested, especially non-Christians, are not interested with what we have to say, and that's not true at all. It's because of our fears maybe, right? But if we share our testimony, we're not pushing down their throat, we're not shoving down their throat to believe what we believe, but there is a place for beautiful conversation where you can share where you are, what you believe, what you stand for. And that's what Paul did. So verse 22, he stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. You know what Paul just did? He was finding a very good, helpful touch point. You know, sometimes when you're trying to minister the gospel to someone else, you do need to know where they come from. In a sense that you do need to have a sense of a bit of their background. If it's your friends, you know where they used to study, where they stay, how many children they have. You know, it's like you know where they are. And Paul wanted to really insert himself. First, where is the level playing field? Ah, I saw you have many idols, but he didn't say it outright. He didn't first say, you guys have many, many idols. You need to, you know, he didn't scold. He started off with a factual statement, something that all of them could relate to. Hey, I could see you're very religious. Verse 23. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship. Notice he didn't say idols, because idols is offensive. He said, these are the objects of your worship. I found also an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. You see what he used as stepping stones, right? He said, hey, I can see you're very religious. Hey, I saw you have an inscription that says, even you are worshiping an unknown God. So let me tell you who this unknown God is. It's interesting, right? He used two stepping stones now. And then he went to verse 24. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by men. Verse 25, nor is he seated by human hands as though God needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. Now, all this are very basic Christian beliefs that you and I hold to. But do you realize that your non-believing friends do not know it? Because, right, even if they do believe there's a higher power, many of them do believe in a plurality of gods. You know, like the bit of the Greek mythology where there's so many gods, you know, like, and who is in control, who quite knows. But for us, we don't believe that, right? We believe that our God is one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but there's no distinction in the sense of there's no power a play. They all know their specific roles. We have one God, three persons. Unique mystery, yes, we'll find out more in heaven, but that's what we believe. And Paul is trying to say, you know, there is only this one God that everything came from. He's trying to dispel the notion to the Athenians that there are many, many gods, so you need many types of worship, you need many types of idols. No, there's only one. Verse 26, and he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place. Verse 27, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he's actually not far from each of us. Verse 28, for in him we live and move and have our being, as some of your poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Verse 29, being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of men. Do you know what Paul said is not offensive, but he did say where he stood. He's literally saying, your idols can't do anything for you, but he's saying in a very polite way that God is so powerful that he should not be trapped in objects of worship like gold and silver and metal, but he's not attacking them. So there is a way, you know, some of us are so fearful, obviously, that when we tell people, hey, you know, I believe in God and Jesus died for my sin, and in our minds we're thinking, what are they going to say? Well, Paul knew that the Athenians didn't believe, but he had to share the truth of the gospel in a palatable way so that people are not going to be upset unnecessarily. Friends, there's a way to share the gospel to our loved ones, that doesn't have to be offensive. Now, there is a level of offense in a sense that, yes, when you say Jesus is the only way, only truth, only life, there is some level of offense, but they should be offended by the truth, not because we added to it, not because we were mean-spirited. We shared the truth. I think what Paul did here was pretty amazing to me. He shared the truth, he shared boldly, he shared with compassion. And he didn't attack where they stood. He's trying to help them to see, you know, there's an unknown God that y'all talk about. Okay, I'm going to tell you this unknown God because he's unknown to you, but he's not unknown to me. He has revealed himself to me. Finishing up. And verse 30, the times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Verse 31, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man, that's talking about Jesus, whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising this man, Jesus, from the dead. A few more verses and we'll conclude our passage. Verse 32, and when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, but others said, we will hear you again about this, right? They're divided. Now, if you have actually shared your testimony and the gospel to non-believing friends and family before, you know that's the case. Typically, I've not really seen that anyone believes it on the first time. I mean, not really often. I've shared before during different parts of my life, and it's more like, yeah, okay, Pesa, I'm willing to hear from you again. And there are maybe those in their heart, they mock, maybe they're too polite, they don't show me. Maybe that's happened for you, right? You share the gospel and there's some people like, nah, I'm not interested at all. And I can't believe that you as an intellectual person, you as a modern person can think of such things. Shouldn't you be more sensible than that? But you see, we are compelled by the love and grace of God to share about who Jesus is. He's the only hope we know. Finishing up, so Paul went out from their midst, but some men joined him and believed, among whom also were, well, I still can't pronounce this, Dionysius the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. So after this whole excursion of sharing the gospel and sharing his testimony, yeah, we see some were divided, some mocked, some were willing to hear again, and also some believed, sharing the gospel to a dying world. Here's a question, okay? Why did Paul share to people that were not related to him? Like, you know, for this year, we really want to talk about our main aim is to at least start with people we love. Share the gospel to our family and friends, people that we love. But Paul, he went all out. He was sharing with people he did not know. See, I think there are stages. I think for us as a church, this is a season. Let's just start from where we stand, our homes, our parents' homes that we visit, right? The people that we know and respect and love. Let's start with them. I think that's the first place that God has given to us. And then as we go along, you know what happens, right? This is one thing that's so amazing. The more we do it, it becomes so second nature to us. You know, it's like, you remember a stage when you're non-Christian? Then when you became a Christian, coming to church becomes a normal thing. Suddenly when we had COVID, no one goes to church, right? And then we're all like watching church online. And once COVID is kind of done, now we're kind of getting back fully on track. Some things have to be learned. Some things is a built habit. Sharing the gospel doesn't just happen automatically. It does require for us to say, do I have compassion for my family and my loved ones? And I submit to you that Paul shared with the Athenians because he had compassion for them. He was provoked. His spirit saw that these people were under bondage and slavery and spiritual darkness and deception. They need the gospel, the only power that can break loose from their old life and bring them to a new life. Now, you know, later on, we actually are going to hold an altar call because as we said, from this week onwards, every single Sunday, we're going to give people an opportunity to know Jesus Christ. It's important, okay? Every single Sunday. So I'm so glad some of you brought your friends today and some of you already asked some of your friends to come. Maybe they can come this week. Well, next week, again, a chance. So every single Sunday, every single Sunday, we're not concerned about how many people come up. We just want to lay the opportunity for people to come and receive the love of God and receive the salvation of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. So how do I conclude? A few things I want to say from my heart because I ask myself this question. The people I love, will I tell them the gospel? Absolutely, I will. Because they are people I love. I want to go to heaven, and the people I love, I want them to go to heaven. Clear, right? Here's where I'm challenged when I see a passage of Acts. When I see Paul going out of his way, because he did it every day. The Bible is very clear. In one of the verses we read, he did it every day. He went to the place of the synagogue, and he began to declare the gospel day after day. He's doing it not just on a Sunday. He was doing it repeatedly, day after day. What would propel a person to do that? I can only think of one thing, right? The love of God, right? It's the love of God. And I want to be really convicted by the Apostle Paul in that regard. Because I want to preach the gospel not only on the pulpit on Sunday, which is the easiest thing to do. I guess it's kind of my job and you pay me to do that kind of, right? So some of you are thinking, so Pastor, I don't have to preach the gospel. I pay you to preach the gospel. So let me get my friends. Do you preach the gospel to them? Well, I'm telling you that we all have to repent on that, right? I don't want to just preach the gospel on the pulpit. Easiest thing to do. Or even in cell group, it's the easiest thing to do. Preaching the gospel outside of a safe place, outside of a church space is where it's difficult. I think we understand. You're sitting in a taxi, the Grab driver is driving, that has become church, you know. But pastor, I don't hear any music. Then I know this Grab driver before that smoking. I can smell a whole car full of smoke, you know. Doesn't this guy need Jesus? Amen. Right? I mean, we are not condemning. We're just saying, doesn't he need Jesus? Suddenly, you're in a new place. You could be traveling, taking a flight. And then the person sitting next to you, oh, pastor, they don't want to be disturbed. They want to sleep. Well, I tell you, they need to be disturbed because if they don't have the gospel, where are they headed to? So a short conversation might just start it off. And again, I share with you one of the simplest things we can do. Really, it's not that hard. Whether food court or we're pumping petrol, there are all this older uncle and aunties that are, you know, helping us with certain things, right? You can slip them some money, say Jesus loves you, Yesu aini, things like that. Just do that. I do that, okay? So I'm sharing with you this because I do that and you see their face light up. They didn't even expect that, right? The pumping petrol, you pass them, Yesu aini. If they're willing to talk, stay a bit more, share the gospel. You can share the gospel in just 1 minute. You say how? God loves you. He sent his son to die for you on the cross so that if you believe in him, turn from your sin, you have new life. You are saved. See, that was less than a minute. That's half a minute. Right? You could do that. But pastor, it's so weird. You know, it's more weird. More weird is more. Many people are heading to destruction. It's worse. I think weird is fine. I think for us to be a bit uncomfortable is fine. Because we need to share the gospel to really a dying world. But friends, I tell you what, for this year, let's start with family and friends. We can make sure that every single person that we know personally, and we know that they know us personally, we begin to say, God, you know, I'm going to tell them. I'll find a way. I'm going to tell them I'm a bit nervous, Lord, you know. What am I going to say? Wow, pastor, I mean, God, this particular person, very smart, you know, maybe, you know, how I'm not so smart, so how, right? Five loaves, two fish, start with what you have. And you'll be amazed, right? They're willing to hear you because they know you, they have a level of respect with you. Maybe even they love you, right? So they're willing to hear. Even if they don't agree, even if they don't believe, they're willing to hear. And friends, this is the year of soul winning. I really firmly believe that the last 2 weeks you've heard our vision. I think that this year we're going to see God really open up doors, you know, to our parents' heart, to our friends' heart, to our colleagues' hearts. He's going to just break loose. And they're going to hear about this God, in him we move and live and have our being. This God who created all the heaven and the world. This God who alone deserves to be worshipped. Now, in 5 minutes' time, we're going to have actually an altar call. Short, right, today's service. But we don't need to be long because we want to make sure that we are giving space for people to know Christ. So this 5 minutes is for you to hear the gospel. And some of you that are very new to church, you were invited, you are here. Or maybe you didn't lift up your hands, but you are new because you've been here a few weeks. And you're kind of saying, I sense something. I don't quite know what's going on. In a summary, this is what you need to know, right? The Bible is very clear. Why the gospel is so important? Because you and I, the Bible says so clearly, are separated from God without hope. You say, what does that mean? It means that we were born as a sinner and we do nasty stuff. Even if not physically, outwardly, in our minds, we think of things that we shouldn't think about. We get angry people, we are hateful, we're lustful, we are prideful, we're worldly, we're carnal. There's so much junk. We know that. Sometimes we see in the news someone go to prison, someone get indicted, and we judge them, but knowing that in our hearts, sometimes we would have done the very same thing if we have a chance not to get caught. The Bible indicts every single human being. It doesn't matter whether you're born rich or poor. It doesn't matter you're born in a great family name or not. You are a sinner like me, which means that we are culpable towards a holy God. And the reason why God would judge us if nothing changes in our current state is that as a sinner against a holy God, God has no choice but to send us to another place different from what we are hoping for. You see, this is what I know about you, even if you're not a Christian, right? I know that you hope when you die, you become nothing, or somehow there's a heaven or paradise. That's the only two options you want. Nothing. I want to be nothing, or yeah, I'm going to a place called paradise. But the Bible does say there's two locations, actually. It's not nothingness. That's not true. It's heaven or hell. Heaven is a place where God's people will be God's forgiven people. God's changed people will be God's transformed. People will be those that believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, turn from their sin and desire to walk in the fullness that God has. Hell is full of not only sinners that do not know God, but even the false Christians. Hell is full of all lies and all malice, and people that go there will not just die. They will die eternally, daily, moment by moment. There's no time, there's no space. They'll be burned. And it's horrendous, just the idea of hell. You know, I believe, friends, that there's a reason why many people over the centuries are passionate to preach the gospel, because you don't just become nothing. You know, let's say honestly, if it's heaven or nothing, that means people that believe in Jesus go to heaven. People that don't believe just become nothing. I don't think I would be preaching the gospel that much, because that's not the worst thing that can happen to a person, right? You become nothing. So you live 80, 100 years on earth, and then poof, you're gone, and that's it. Nowhere you are going except nothing. That's not too bad. Because my Bible, and many of you Christians' Bible, it does tell us so clearly, there is a judgment day. God, who sits on his throne, will judge the living and the dead. And for those that are acquitted of their sins, they will find their resting place. And heaven and everyone else will be sentenced to an eternal hell. That propels me to share the gospel, honestly. So the gospel is this: you're a sinner, I'm a sinner, but there is a hope that God prepared. Because 2,000 years ago, you might have heard this before, but it's worth hearing it again, all right? If you have heard this before and you said, but I don't really want it, maybe today you might consider hearing it one more time with an open heart, okay? With an open heart, that God, 2,000 years ago, sent his precious, beloved, only Son, Jesus Christ. He came to earth. He was the God in flesh, the God-man, the God incarnate, lived a perfect, sinless life at the age of 30, did public ministry, healed the sick, taught people, showed the disciples the way. And then at the age of 33, he went to a Roman cross and died brutally on our behalf for our sins. You say, what? And this is the reason why. It's a mystery to us in some regards, but this is the reason why. Because as guilty sinners, we are actually condemned to die, for sure. Unless there is a substitute, a replacement, some person that came. The Bible calls him Jesus, the Lamb of God, that was slain for the sins of the world. Jesus died so we could live. At any point in time, Jesus could have said, Father, I don't want to do this. And the legion of angels would have charged down and brought Jesus to safety. But Jesus went to the cross, naked, hung, bled, died for you and me. You said, okay, this is new. What do I do? Well, Bible teaches us to repent and place our faith in Jesus. Repent is a change of mind, change of life, change of heart. We desire to say, I'm done with my old life. And I want a new life, a life that is clean, a life that's forgiven, a life full of grace. And it starts with the blood of Jesus. Jesus died so you and I can live. See, that's the gospel, friends. And before we hold an altar call, I want to say this to all our Christian brothers and sisters, Tampines, Woodlands, those of you online, you don't have to preach the gospel like I did. In my way, right? This is Pastor Pace's way of doing it. I preach differently from my dad. And my son in the future, if he's going to be a pastor, he's going to preach differently from me. You don't have to preach like me, but we have to tell people the urgency of the gospel. It's the only hope that anyone has beyond this life. It's the only hope for true salvation, for true union and fellowship with God. So this is what we're going to do, okay? In 2 minutes' time, I'll ask us all to stand. Don't stand here. And we'll give you space and just a bit of time for those of you that say, you know what, today I want to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And then we hope that you can come up from your seats and come to the front in Willens as well. I know the steps look long. It's not steps, but you're counting the steps. So pastor, I'm sitting right at the back. 20 steps to the front. 20 steps, not too troubling. I tell you why. Because Jesus walked miles holding the cross to die for you. This is 20 steps is not too bad. And so we're going to have you respond and say, today is a day I am going to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Quickly, one more thing. For those of you that brought friends, I don't want you to force them out, okay? Because Jesus doesn't need our pity beliefs, right? For those of you that come up, you truly want it. I don't want you to feel forced. Please, don't feel forced. But if you brought a friend, it's okay to encourage them as we sing the song to say, hey, ready or not? Can I? Okay? But don't force them. Can I? What am I? Can I? What am I? Don't. Okay, we don't need that. But if they are willing, hold them by the hand and say, okay, let's go down. I'll stand with you, okay? Those of you that brought friends, would you bring them? Come alongside, okay? You know, they feel so nervous coming down, all right? You already know this church. They don't know this church, so please do that. Are we all ready to see the Lord do amazing things in our midst? Amen. Shall we all stand, Tampines, Woodlands? All right. Worship team, get ready. As we sing this song, for those of you that say, okay, today is the day I want to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to place my faith in Jesus. Will you make your way to the front and join us as we pray together? Thank you, Lord. Amen.
The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Keep responding, friend.
Come to the altar.
Maybe we're not used to it yet. So let's close our eyes for a minute, okay? Just close your eyes. This will help a little. For those of you that say, you know, I actually want to go up. I want to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, but I'm a bit nervous. I want you to take a moment now to consider the truth. God sent His Son, died for you on the cross, so that you can find freedom, be forgiven, find life, find eternity. Completely transformed by the Lord. Now, no one looking, because this might be causing some nervousness. If some of you say, you know what, today is the day I want to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, with no one looking, will you please stretch out your hands up high so I could see? All right, up high, okay. Wow, there's one of you. Okay, just leave your hand there. Okay, the next thing, all right, there's three of you that lift up your hands here in Tampines. Woodlands, anyone lifting up their hands? All right, one or two. For those of you that lift up your hands with all our eyes closed, guys, let's close our eyes, okay? Let's make it easier. Can those that lift up their hands please come to the front? I saw you, sister. Come on to the front. I saw you at the back and one there as well. Come on. Don't be shy. Are you ready to come? Okay, I'm not going to force you, but if you don't want, you just stay where you are. Okay. Woodlands, anyone? I just saw one or two hands earlier on. My gosh. Okay, friends, now look at me for a minute. It's okay, all right? Week one, so we'll get used to it, okay? Every week will get easier, right? So now you know what's going to happen. You say, Pastor, this feels like altar call in America service. Yeah, altar call in America service, we're used to it. So many people come out, right? So this Sunday, never mind, we'll take it slow. Next week, bring friends, prepare them, okay? Pray, prepare them. And when we call altar call, we'll see many people respond. But right now, actually, we have three that responded that don't want to come up, it's fine. And then we have a brother that responded in the front. Let's give the Lord praise first. Amen. It's awesome though. It's awesome. Shall we stretch our hands to our brother in the front? For the three of you that I saw your hands lifted earlier on, don't need to come up now, but just pray alongside, okay? Hey, awesome, you know. We have this service, brother. We have this service just for you to come to know Christ. You know how awesome that is? You know how awesome that is? And the Bible is clear that if one comes into the kingdom of God, the angels are rejoicing. So the church of Jesus Christ, we rejoice, we rejoice. Wow. Stretch your hands to Him. Were you? For those of you that want to repeat after me and respond to Jesus, would you say this prayer right now? Dear Lord Jesus, I admit I'm a sinner and I need the Savior. Today, I surrender my life into your hands. Lord Jesus, I believe you died for me. I believe that you desire to forgive all my sin. And today I commit my life before you. Forgive me of every sin. Make me a child of God. From this day forth, I desire to walk with you, to follow you, to do what you ask of me. I give you thanks. In Jesus' name. And all of us say amen. Welcome to the family, brother. Welcome. Let's give him a hand. Welcome. Praise God. God bless you. Now, before we close our service, right? Listen, church. This is exciting, okay? I'm so excited for what has just happened. And every single week, trust me about this, we're going to see many, 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 many more come. Today was already a great success. Because seeds are sown, right? Seeds are sown. Friends, next week, your moms, your dads, bring them to hear the gospel in church. Let them hear that Jesus actually loves them. Let them hear that God wants them to know Him. Could I pray with us on this? Worship team will lead us and then Pastor Tim will close us in service. Would you lift up your hands and let's spend a moment now praying again for our family. And our loved ones. Heavenly Father, you see all our lifted hands. There is a spiritual charge in this room that we can sense. It's so awesome. There's a sense of mission, the mission of seeing the gospel go out to family and friends. We want to see them saved. And for some of them, they're going to maybe watch this later on YouTube. For some of them, as the seeds are being sown, they're going to be willing to come. One of these weeks, they're going to be willing to come with us to church. We want them to find life. Oh God, right now we lift up all the people that are so close to our hearts, oh God. They are gonna know Jesus and the grace of God this year. We proclaim it. We proclaim it. We affirm it. We proclaim it now. We wanna believe that very strongly, oh God. Please continue to do the mighty work of drawing them by your Spirit. Our families, our friends shall know Jesus Christ. And all of us say, would you give the Lord praise? Amen.